novels, Charles, graphic novelist 1200. Night Owl was one of these title crime fighters in an Alan Moore graphic novel, later a movie. Morgan.
What is Watchmen?
Yes.
Graphic novels for 2000?
Answer.
Hi everyone, and welcome to Paper and Light, the YouTube channel about movie posters. Every episode I like to talk about one poster from my collection, the film it's advertising, and what kind of artwork they use for the physical media releases. And I'm out here in the night, since it seemed like the best location to talk about a gritty, desaturated stroll down 1980s filthy New York streets. I'm talking about 2009's Watchmen.
What?
Oh my goodness.
Hold on. No, no. This blue man's backside is all over the place.
Oh. I dropped a hint about this movie in our last episode, and a big congrats to YouTube user KimmelYam for guessing it in record time.
All I want to do is keep being able to do this. I love it so much. It makes me so happy.
My poster for this film is a teaser one sheet measuring 27 inches by 40 inches. And I got it along with another teaser for the film from one of my local movie theaters back in 2009. I love both of these posters, but the Rorschach one is definitely my favorite. I even have sort of a loose personal connection with this poster. And to tell that story, we need to go on a field trip. A field trip to Burnaby, BC. It's about a 20 to 30 minute drive outside of downtown Vancouver here in British Columbia, and it's part of what we call the Lower Mainland. Burnaby's actually churned out some fairly famous people over the years, including Michael J. Fox, Michael Bublé, and Trinity herself, Carrie Ann Moss. I actually used to live here back in 2008, and according to some online info that I had read, they were filming a little movie there called Watchmen, directed by Zack Snyder, no less. All of my friends and I had gone to see 300 at the IMAX at midnight. We'd all read the graphic novel. We were psyched for this movie. And then that trailer dropped. Still slaps, still a great trailer. So my friends and I were excited, so excited, in fact, that we hatched a plan. And by plan, I mean we snuck into the film studio in the middle of the night. Speaking of film studio, here it is. This field trip is not going well. So it looks like until very recently, there was in fact a film studio here. I haven't been to Burnaby in quite a while, and the last time I looked it up on Google Maps, there was still a film studio here. But obviously it has recently been torn down, and this is where they film Watchmen, and this is where we snuck in. One of my friends is actually a photographer, and he brought his camera and tripod along that night, and what we ended up finding did not disappoint. On the studio backlot, they'd actually constructed an entire 1980s New York City block. And everything was still there. The props, the lights, the signage, everything. We explored as quietly as we could. Some of the buildings were just facades, and there was nothing behind them, and others had actual hallways and rooms inside. It was amazing. We came across this one building that was full of neon signs. We looked at everything, and then we decided to pose in the middle of the street, like some sort of emo band about to release their debut EP.
Watchmen! How's watching the Watchmen? How is watching?
One of us didn't know how little time he had left with his hair. I'd never seen a real film set before, let alone props and lighting and gear. This was all amazing just to witness some of that movie magic. So after exploring for hours, we didn't want to press our luck anymore, and we tiptoed back out into the night. We didn't take anything but photos, and we didn't leave anything but fingerprints? Footprints? I'm sure they probably somehow figured out that we were there, but we didn't take anything. That's the important part. This is where I paused the story, unfortunately, to tell you Do not do this. Number one, this was 2008. They had security cameras back then, but now they're everywhere and they're in 4K. Number two, it's a miracle that we weren't caught, which means you probably will be. And number three, I am fully aware that I'm using this story for internet clout, and it's incredibly hypocritical of me to now tell you to not follow in my footsteps. I'm totally aware. It's a long, time-honored internet tradition that I'm semi-ashamed to be a part of. So as more and more trailers for the film came out, we got more and more amped. And that reached a fever pitch when I came across this teaser poster at my local theater. There they were. The neon signs that we'd actually physically touched. They were in the f***ing poster itself. Amazing. So March 2009 finally rolls around. We've got our tickets. We see Watchmen and... Certain films can live up to that kind of hype, but it's rare, and unfortunately, we all walked away from Watchmen a little bit disappointed. Which isn't to say that Watchmen is a terrible movie, it's not. I just personally don't think it should have been made as a movie, despite being 2 hours and 40 minutes, or 3.5 hours if you watch the ultimate cut.
I rented us the 4-hour edition of Watchmen.
Got it.
Seen it.
Detailed analysis posted online.
There just isn't enough time to delve deeply enough into some of these characters. This really should have been a series, but comic book prestige TV just didn't exist yet. Also, Zack Snyder adopted a slavish dedication to the graphic novel, adapting every frame that he possibly could.
In the graphic novel, graphic novel, graphic novel,
graphic novel,
graphic novel,
graphic novel,
graphic novel,
graphic novel,
graphic novel,
graphic novel.
It was important to me that every now and then we just sort of dive into a frame from the graphic novel, and this was another opportunity. You see when Dan sits down, a lot like that frame right there.
But these two mediums are not the same. Snyder pulls off some incredible visuals, action sequences, and loves to remind the audience that he directed 300. And a lot of these scenes just needed more. More character development, more emotional stakes.
Did you and Dr. Manhattan have a fight today?
That's none of your f***ing business.
It is when you're on government payroll and you're not doing your job.
Since Watchmen was filmed locally here in the Lower Mainland, they ended up using some of our local newscasters, including Lynn Collier and Mi Zhang Li, which I always thought was kind of a cool touch. For me, Watchmen will always be one of those movies that never lived up to the movie that I'd already made in my own mind. The opening title sequence is a masterpiece, but the rest of the film never really achieves those heights again. There are some very off-putting musical choices at times. Some wooden performances.
I'm not a comic book villain.
And a lack of character realism. But I'm not some Zack Snyder hater. I actually really enjoyed 300, and Man of Steel might be my favorite Superman movie, which I've been told is wrong in every conceivable way. On the other hand, I would say Rebel Moon is one of the worst movies I've seen in a long time. So... hit and miss. That's my take anyways, and I know not everyone agrees. Watchmen is currently sitting at a 65% positive rating on Rotten Tomatoes and went on to gross $185 million at the global box office against a $130 million budget, making it a financial disappointment but not a disaster. In order to market the film, Warner Brothers turned to Mojo Print, which rebranded as Percival & Associates in 2012. They created a series of teasers, one-sheets, and character posters, and honestly, this is one of the most impressive poster campaigns I've ever come across. These posters were designed with passion, and it shows. So, what artwork did they use for the physical media? Let's see what I was able to find.
So first up, we have the Watchmen DVD. I love this. I think it's really nice and clean. Obviously, wish I had the American version without all of this additional text. I just think it makes it look really busy. I'm pretty sure even the French people would agree that that is a very messy looking spine. Oh, Canada. Next up, we have the Blu-ray, and this is one of those lenticular covers, a bit of a 3D effect to the artwork. Kind of cool. It's the same artwork as the DVD. As you can see, I did my own little alteration there. To be honest, I'm not even really sure if they released the theatrical cut on Blu-ray and DVD. They probably did, but I've only ever seen the director's cut, at least here in Canada. It's so interesting when these digital copies used to come on a disc, and I guess you'd have to enter in a code, but you would also also have to have the disc itself.
Offer expires July 21st, 2010. That didn't give you a ton of time to get that digital copy. I mean, you gotta be on that. Little Paper and Light alumni there, Constantine. I like the artwork on the disc. I love the blue-green color tones that they used for the majority of the promotions for this film. It is really nice to look at. And next up, we have the 4K Blu-ray. So I think they went with this artwork to kind of integrate Watchmen and the Tales of the Black Freighter. I don't really like this artwork. It kind of just ends up looking like a goofy pirate movie. That's not the main crux of the film. I think some of the other artwork from the original promotional campaign would have been a lot stronger. And the ultimate cut is 3.5 hours long. So this is the original Watchmen graphic novel. It's the bound version of all of the comics that came out. And there are the creators, Alan Moore and Dave Gibbons. Alan Moore, of course, not taking any royalties, and I believe he gave all of the rights of the story to Dave Gibbons. If you're not into comic books or graphic novels or anything like that, if you pick this one up, I don't think you would walk away regretting the experience for sure. One of the gold standards of the format. And this is the art of the film for Watchmen. This is a coffee table book. I love these movie coffee table books. They're some of my favorite things. Even movies that I wouldn't say are my favorite, I'm still interested to see all of the design and all of the creative risks that people took, because sometimes it pans out and sometimes it doesn't. And finally, we have the Watchmen vinyl soundtrack. This artwork is right side up, and then the artwork on the back is upside down. I'm not really sure why that would be. It's not a big deal, but it's kind of interesting. Oh, nice. I maybe would have reordered these characters a little bit. I probably would have put Rorschach in the middle. I think both of these are pretty cool. Let's take a look inside here. Yeah, I wonder how many collectors are out there getting the Melrose Place on vinyl. Earth Girls are easy. I would definitely get that. There's 3 records in here. Kind of a Dr. Manhattan Blue, I think is what they've called this. And that's one of my favorite images from the movie for sure. Visually dynamic, visually interesting. So what do I actually think of this poster? What's the art score? A is for aesthetics. How good is the design? How pleasing is the typography? The overall visuals and the vibe of the poster? Basically, is it nice to look at? I think this poster is dripping with atmosphere. It really transports me into the film. There's a lot to take in here, a lot of compelling details. You can feel the tension between these characters trying to entice Rorschach and his rather imposing stance as he walks down the street, apparently unconcerned with oncoming traffic. Vite Tower looms in the background while the neon glow reflects on the rain-soaked streets. Despite the scene taking place at night, it's actually a very colorful, vibrant poster. So vibrant that it outmatches the film itself, given Zack Snyder's propensity for desaturated colors at the time. The overall composition draws your eye to either Rorschach or the tagline above. Without even seeing his face, you can feel his disgust. The tagline reinforces his sense of righteous self-importance and is delivered coldly by the character himself.
This city's afraid of me. I've seen its true face.
I love that they slightly skewed the tagline to make it appear as though it's hovering above the city, like it's Rorschach's floating bitterness. The Yellow Watchman title is straight from the graphic novel, and I particularly love the numerical symmetry of the 369 release date. My only real critique with this poster is I think it missed an opportunity. It has a certain vibe with Rorschach walking away from us, but with his face, the design of his mask, I think it would have added another point of intrigue if he was staring us down instead. For aesthetics, I'm giving this poster a 2 out of 3. R is for representation. Does it represent the film very well? Does it match the look and feel and the ideas it's presenting? Is there a sense of story? This is essentially a scene from the movie in poster form. It's depicting a main character whose dialogue it uses as the tagline. Pretty hard to get more representative than that. It presents in flashy detail one of the central themes of the film, Rorschach's absolute, unshakable sense of justice. For representation, I'm giving this poster a 3 out of 3. T is for titillation. Does this poster inspire any excitement or intrigue? Does it make us want to go watch the movie? As I've already mentioned, I was beyond hype for this movie, and seeing this poster for the first time only added to that hype. The yellow title is instantly recognizable to anyone who's read the graphic novel, and despite only seeing the back of him, we all knew who this character was. Even though I feel that not everything came together perfectly in this movie, I would say that the depiction of Rorschach is probably the best element within it. There's something so interesting about watching him lurk around in the night, solving mysteries and just being completely insufferable.
And all the whores and politicians will look up and shout, "Save us." And I'll whisper, "No."
Essentially, this poster reminds me of the best parts of this movie. For titillation, I'm giving this a 3 out of 3. With an art score of 8 out of 10, it's easy to see my enthusiasm for this poster. But what about that final point? What did my wife think?
Okay, what do you think?
Oh, I love this poster. Such great colors. Yeah, this is beautiful.
Because you did not like this movie.
No, I found this movie to be an incredible slog.
I did make you watch the ultimate 3.5-hour cut with me.
I didn't know that there was a shorter version.
I'm sorry about that. Okay, wife point approved.
Yeah, wife point.
Wow, with a final art score of 9 out of 10, this poster is close to perfect and well-deserved. Good art makes you feel, and this poster makes me feel melancholy, but in a good way, if that makes any sense. We've all been there. You're walking home in the rain. Maybe you had a terrible day. Maybe you saw something in the city streets that disgusted you, but you felt powerless. When I look at this, I see someone who views the world as black and white, right and wrong, an unforgiving binary. It can be in my nature to do that sometimes too, and it feels like a visual reminder of what that can ultimately lead to. Not to get all personal, but that's what good art does. It makes it personal. It's also just cool looking. It's cool. It's a cool poster. There's rain. He's wearing a cool hat.
And the night reeks of fornication and bad consciences.
I believe any good collection needs to be shared, and in that spirit, I'm going to be giving away the Watchmen Art of the Film coffee table book. Written by Peter Aperlow, it's a deep dive into everything that went into this film production. Sets, props, concept drawings, costumes, and there's an entire chapter just on the designs of these movie posters. If you'd like a chance to win this coffee table book, all you need to do is head over to my Patreon, the link to which will be in the description box below. We do a major giveaway with every episode of Paper and Light. Your name will be entered into a draw, and we ship the prizes worldwide. I really appreciate that support, which goes towards getting more cool stuff to show you in future episodes. Well, I hope you've enjoyed this stroll down the filthy streets of 1980s New York City. For our next episode, we're actually going to be talking about a movie that was released in the 1980s. I've already dropped some hints about this in my Best and Worst of 2023 video, so go check out that episode and make your guess in the comments. And while you're down there, consider subscribing to Paper and Light, maybe click on that bell. I have a lot of great episodes coming up in the future, and I don't want you to miss anything. Thank you so much for watching. I can't wait to show you more.
Died in New York.